a doubter, do it without the damn powder. Hear the facts, people real when I got your back. Show your love in the right relax, like a mirror full of cracks. Hey, who you talking to? Hold that, let me talk. Talking cheap when I got no walk, and I got no right to play your part. Hit my heart, hit my soul. Got my faith, then I got my goals. 24, I'm in that mode. Mama, they call me beast mode. Hey, who you talking to? Talking, hey, hey. Come around my way, okay. I can be that preacher, brothers. Keep a true believer, leader to achievers. I can be that, fill you up when you want that feedback. Hey.
I'm here to tell you that your whole life can change in a moment. And this is that moment.
And this is the word.
Good morning, good evening, and good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to The Word Podcast, Season 4, Episode 1 and 2. I am your host, Steve.
And I'm Dan. How's it going, everyone? Guess what, ladies and gentlemen? It's happening. Today, we're talking about Season 4, Episode 1 and 2, so we got a double play for you today.
We already did the prelims, ladies and gentlemen, and so we could just get right into it. Dan, are you excited? You're about to do a lot of talking this episode. A lot.
I am about to do a lot of talking. Yeah. Maybe we should square a couple things away.
Yes.
If you're new to the show, maybe you're just listening to us for the first time. Hey, welcome. We are The Word, the Unofficial Preacher Podcast. That guy over there, that's Steve. I'm Dan. I know we already introduced ourselves, but some people don't pay attention, you know, drive in traffic and such. Now, normally when we do this, we have a little bit of banter, kind of loosen things up a little bit, and then we go into a full-on breakdown. And when I say full-on breakdown, you want to know what picture's hanging on the wall? That's what you're going to find out. Today, because Preacher was kind enough to give us two episodes dropping at the same time, we're going to go through it a little bit quicker than we normally do. So you want a little more in-depth breakdown, come back next week. I assure you it'll be there. Other than that, we're pretty much going to jump into this. Steve, anything you want to address before we get started?
No, I'm just really excited. I can't wait to get into this. I just watched the episodes, of course, right before the show. And so I'm pumped. I'm ready. I'm going to give my opinions throughout. But ladies and gentlemen, we have to kind of get through this today. So I'm not going to give too many Steve Areno opinions. But I will say what I need to say throughout. But it's going to be us trying to get through this because this is two shows in a row. Can't wait. Let's rock and roll.
Real quick, man. Let's do a little litmus test and see where you're at. So you were able to watch both episodes. Quick thoughts.
Look, man, I did not expect to like it as much as I did.
Oh, good, good. All right.
I loved the first two episodes.
Glad to hear it.
I'm almost going to say that I like it more than something else I did not expect, but let's move to it.
Okay. All right. Well, it's kind of good. You know, let's talk a little bit about it before we just dive into it. You know, and I'm changing directions because we got to treat you people right. So I too loved both episodes. Now, initially when I first watched them, because I have seen them twice, it was a different feel. Would you not agree, Steve, that it's like the pacing's a lot different this season?
Totally.
And I think that the main reason for that is because, of course, we have one season to get all this stuff in here. So my prediction for the season is going to be a lot of fan service, which I'm okay with because I think that they are going to be throwing things at us rapid fire. And I kind of like that because it's kind of weird. Preacher has trained us to go slow, you know, pace ourselves. And we were building up and building up and building up. And then things change, obviously. Last season's here. And they're like, you know what? Strike all of that. Let's go full speed ahead. So it's kind of exciting, man. You know, for our last season, I think it's cool because I honestly don't know what's going to happen, particularly with like different characters and different story arcs, how they're going to work those back into the story. But they are somehow doing that. And I can tell you that I'm quite pleased with the first two episodes. So that's good, man. I'm glad we're both on the same page.
Oh, I am just super jazzed. I'm not going to lie.
Nice.
All right, let's rock and roll. All right, here we go.
Rock and roll we shall. All right, ladies and gentlemen, this is the part where I say it's breakdown time. So what we're going to do is we're just going to go straight into episode one, entitled Masada, written by Kevin Rosen, directed by John Grillo. And then we're going to knock out episode two. Are you ready, folks? Good. Great. Let's do it. Steve, we start off. We see Tulip popping the cap off some Middle Eastern beer. I have no idea what it is. She's loading a rifle. She lights up a cigarette. Camera pans out, and we find her sitting on a bed. It can also be said that it's not her first beer. She's had several beers so far. Door opens up. Someone comes in, puts his own rifle down, and she's like, her guy can get us in. Person kind of grunts like, you know, he's implying yes. And then she's like, good. Screams can be heard from outside. I don't know if you caught that or not, but you can hear from, I don't know if it's coming from their window or through the hallway of where they're staying, but you can hear these screams and moans and things like that, which they don't really touch on, I don't think, yet anyway. This mystery person sits down, and who is it? It's Cassidy, and he's looking way better than he was the last time that we saw him, because, you know, the last time we saw him, he was all strung up underneath the Archangel in the tombs of Masada.
Looks amazing. He looks amazing. And I did not know that was going to be Cassidy. I ain't going to lie.
It was surprising to say the least. Again, you know, it makes me feel like there's some type of a time jump involved. And we will touch on that. Yes. But it's a very subtle time jump. Yes. It's not that much. You know what I mean? So much like this whole season, there's going to be a lot happening in a little amount of time.
Love it.
So Cassie's sitting on the bed with Tulip, and she tells him it feels like it's the end almost. Cassie's like, I guess we all got to die sometime. But these screams keep continuing, and they never touch on that. So it's puzzling to me, Steve. I'm a little concerned about these mystery people. We have no idea what's going on.
The funny thing is, I'm excited already. When it starts this, I'm excited already, because I'm like, I forgot how much I missed the show.
Yeah, it's just nice to be back, right?
Yes.
Ah, the trio. We're going to miss them. But let's not focus on that right now. Let's talk about the present. You know what I mean? Or maybe yes. It's the past. I'm not entirely sure. Remember, there's some type of a time jump. So this is the part that I like. Cassidy decides to get a little bit judgy with Tulip, and he actually comments on all of the beers that she's drinking. She's like, I like beer, Cass. Cassidy decides to lighten up the mood a little bit and tell Tulip a joke. And since we haven't heard this man's voice for a while, I thought I would go ahead and insert an audio clip right here.
Patrick and Murphy, they're out fishing at sea, and the engine on the boat dies. So Murphy just says, look, we're just going to have to sit here and wait for help. So for 2 full days, they're lost at sea. And you see this little bot. And it's just bobbing around in the waves. So Patrick, he scoops it up and he opens it. And out pops a genie. And he grants them one wish. And Patrick says, all right, turn the whole sea into Guinness. Just like that, the whole sea goes black with Guinness. Murphy says to Patrick, when the hell you do that for? Now I'm going to have to piss in the boat.
So yeah, the man likes Guinness, Steve. You like Guinness?
I don't like beer.
Oh, that's right. That's right. I've offered you a beer before, and you took a cider instead, I believe.
Oh,
that's okay.
That beer
I'm not judging
ridiculous.
You.
Ridiculous. Go ahead, yeah.
It's an acquired taste.
Yeah. Like other things I don't do, like the Babadook.
There's a whole other show called Heroes of Noise, folks. Listen to that.
No, let's go.
I got to stay on task today, buddy. So after Cassidy tells her this joke, they kind of have this little silent moment. You know those moments where two people make eye contact and we know what's going to happen, Steve, because it's happened before. So Tulip actually leans in to give Cass a kiss. Mm-hmm. And they both kind of embrace for a little bit longer and they take the second kiss and then they like fall back onto the bed and that's where we cut. So apparently they're back at it again, those crazy kids. They're all sexed up.
Yeah.
We then hear the sound of a large airplane. And we see this figure falling to earth, Steve.
So good. I lost my mind.
Oh, man. Like, I just got so happy when I saw that.
Oh, my gosh.
For those of you that aren't familiar with the comic, it's a pretty heavy hitting part into the comic. So we were very happy to see this. Let me tell you what happens. We find out that it's Jesse. And I did see him filming this on Instagram last year. He didn't really fall, folks. So I saw him all strung up. I know. I'm sorry, okay. Man. But I saw him strung up with a little cable and he's in this green room and he's just spinning. So I assume that's what it is because that's the only time I've ever seen him in that position, right?
Yes.
So Jesse's spiraling to Earth and it's got to be a certain death. He's going to die. I'm sure of it because, you know, no one falls from that high, lands on the desert floor and lives. But we'll see what happens. So right there, we see Australia flash across the screen in Preacher style. And if you look closely, you actually see Jesse hit the Earth in the distance. If you're not sure and you don't believe me, the camera zooms in and there's Jesse who's laying dead on the ground, eyes wide open and blood's coming from his left ear. From there, we cut to Tulip, whose car is speeding towards us, and we get another flash across the screen that says a couple months before. So there's our time jump. It's just a couple months. Seems like a lot more. I don't know how this is going to work out, but I'm excited.
I'm very excited.
So she's doing roughly 95, Steve, in her car, skidding back and forth across the dirt. And right across the screen again, we get another flash. This time, it says Middle East. So let's establish where we're at here. It's a couple months before all this. We're now in the Middle East.
With her car somehow.
Now, the cost of shipping that thing's got to be like more than they can afford, being that none of them have steady jobs, right?
Yes. I mean, I got to assume. And that car is nice.
Right. It's well kept. So whoever did the shipping on that, you know, kudos to them.
Incredible.
This is one of those things where I believe they call that suspension of disbelief because no one's going to ship that car over. It's way too expensive.
You make great logical points in a show like this. Thank you.
You know, you have to find the sanity within the insanity, Steve.
Shoot. But anyway, back to the angel that's strung up in the tunnel.
But back to the foreskins. Yeah. But more on that later.
Oh, so good. Anyway.
Yeah, that comes full circle.
Yes.
No pun intended.
Wow.
No, it was horrible.
No, that was good, dude.
I will take that, sir. So like I said, Steve, the car is skidding back and forth on this road. Why would they do that? Why would they drive so carelessly across the road? Well, we find out why. Because once we see inside the vehicle, we find Jesse, who's bent over the back seat, buckling up his belt. So they had a little bit of the road sexy, buddy.
Oh, yes. You ever done that? No, I don't have the gift of driving like that. And that would be like, a lot can happen in 20 seconds, Dan.
Yeah, I mean, if they don't want you texting, I imagine that you probably shouldn't be performing coitus as well. But that's just me. I am a little bit on the conservative side. Not with politics, folks. Just, I don't like to die on the road is what I'm getting at. Tulip tells Jesse, we haven't done that in a long time. And Jesse tells her, I love you. She says, till the end of the world. And Jesse, you know what he says, Stevie? He says, till the end of the world. So like I said, they're throwing out all the stuff. They're hitting us in the feels right now. And I'm happy with it.
Yes, they are. I love it.
I'm hoping that you comic fans are happy about it, too. From there, we get another, like, they're flashing like crazy right now. They're not flashing their goodies, ladies and gentlemen. They're doing the flashes, the font flashes that we so enjoy. And the next flash we get is Preacher. The intro starts, and Steve, I like the new footage with this one.
Love it.
You know, there's something at the end that I'm not going to reveal, because I feel if you missed it the first time, it's totally worth going back and watching it. But I think it's like the last shot of the trio. At the very end of the song, you know, the intro song.
Yes.
And there's something there that made me extremely happy. So again, fan service like crazy. Kind of goes with what we just talked about with Jesse falling. Very, very happy about that.
Mm-hmm.
If you have regular TV, this is the point where you go to commercial. But we're not there. So we come on back and we get this overhead shot of Masada, the mountainside of Masada. They got a drone or something like that.
Yes.
Or a camera, or probably just CGI. You know what I'm saying? The camera zooms down into what I could only assume would be some type of... Was a skylight? I don't know what the hell it is, because why do you need something like that at Masada? I'll tell you why. Because if you just keep on following that down right there, what do we see? We see the Archangel. Now, I mentioned this guy last week. He's a new character to the series of Preacher. However, if you're not familiar with who the Archangel is, I feel like I might be spoiling this a little bit, but if you followed us this far, I think you know what's up. That's Genesis's daddy right there.
Very interesting. His face was not what I expected.
No, me neither.
Yeah, I thought it was going to be like a younger, like, you know, like, oh, he's a pretty boy.
To me, Steve, he looked like Daniel Craig, who'd been drinking for about 4 years straight, 12 hours a day.
That is funny.
Yeah, he looks like a rough Daniel Craig.
Yeah, I mean, I think that they went an interesting direction. I do wish they would have gotten someone that looks like, oh, that is your tip. Since they're going totally stereotypical, just go with your typical looking angel guy.
Yeah, some handsome, tall dude.
Yeah, and then the end, be like, oh, they caught this guy. Him, I was like, they caught him, but it didn't seem like it was hard to catch him. But maybe later on, when they show what he's capable of, we'll be like, oh.
He found love, Steve. He found love. So really, I think that maybe we're the judging ones, and
you know,
perhaps
what,
the angel can see through all of that and know that there's more to personality.
You know what? Why am I even? You're totally right.
There's a little bit of beauty in all of us.
That is true. That is true.
There's a lot more of it in me, Steve, but most people have a little bit of beauty.
That barrel chest, dude. That's what it's all about.
So, yeah, the Archangel is hanging. He's seen better days. He's hanging kind of crucifix style, if you will. His wings are spread. His arms are spread. He's suspended with chains, and he's muttering loudly to himself, talking to himself like crazy. Below, you hear the annoyed Cassidy telling him to shut your hole, Birdman. The door to his cell opens. The door to his cell opens up, and who walks in? Friend of the show, Julianne Emery, aka Featherstone, enters the room.
Well, how'd you like seeing your friend on screen?
I think it's great, man. I think that she is in her bag so far. Like, I know.
Oh, dude.
I know for a fact that she, well, I don't know for a fact, actually. Maybe we'll find out soon. But to me, it seems like she probably had the most fun filming this time around.
Oh, it sounds like it. I mean, this is Featherstone to the Featherstonist. I love it.
Yeah, she's great. I mean, I think that she really adds to the show, and she gives us something where it's like we get a little bit more action, but we also get some comedy with it.
Agreed.
Big fan of Featherstone, Steve.
Yeah, she's your buddy. I know. You had two conversations with her.
Two whole conversations. So, you know, we're lifelong friends.
Hey, listen.
I'm going to like her family's weddings and things like that now. It's crazy.
I knew it.
It cost me a lot because I live in California, and most of her family's back east. So
it's a catch-22.
It really, oh, I see what you did there, sir. Catch 22, now on Hulu. It's an entertaining show. So Cassidy is not feeling as excited as we are about her entering the room, and he greets her as Nurse Ratchet, asks if she has come to give him his lithium. The Archangel, he's continuing to mutter upstairs. She tells him to shut up and put his wings away or they're going to saw him off.
Which she would do.
Yeah, she totally would. She says, let's go, come on, come hither, something like that. But she summons Cassidy to get his ass up, and they now make their way out. So as they're walking, Cassidy asks Featherstone about his favorite traitor, Hoover, because he owes him a bit of a beatdown, is what he's telling her. And she tells him that Hairstar set him on fire, to which he replies, right, no need for that then. So we should take this time to bow our heads and now finally accept that Malcolm Barrett is not on the show. So no Hoover, we are not going to get, maybe I shouldn't say that just yet, but there's supposed to be something that happens with some sand. Maybe they will give us some kind of a nod, but it's not going to be the same. It's like when you go over your grandma's house and you're like, grandma, I want a hamburger. And then she tries to make you a hamburger, but she uses like Wonder Bread instead of buns. It's the same. You know what I mean? If the thought is there, you appreciate that. You appreciate all of her efforts, but it's not the same thing.
Hoover, nobody does it like you.
Sir, you will be missed.
Yes.
So as this is going down, a Grail Guard places Cass in shackles and they lead him down this corridor. Now, this episode's very groan and cry heavy because as they're going down this corridor, exactly what you hear, groans and cries. They can be heard coming from either side of the cells that are lining the corridor. Cass tells Featherstone, I love what Lord Frankenstein has done with the place, really letting the dank and dark run wild. Because he's a smart ass, Stephen. We love him for it, right? Even in times of peril, this man's got a sense of humor.
Of course.
They climb this spiraling staircase and they walk past this other prisoner and he and Cass exchange glances and I don't know if there's anything to that. I think they were just like, oh, you're screwed too? Yeah, hey, what's up? You know, maybe I'll see you around the yard or something like that. They eventually enter this big, great hall. I'm going to call it a great hall of sorts. It's lit by hundreds of candles. There's sunlight shining through this large stained glass window. And the glass is formed to make a picture of none other than Humperdoo, the Messiah child.
Which is crazy.
I mean, he's not an attractive guy.
No.
Tyson Ritter, pretty attractive guy. Humperdoo, not so much. So
not even close, but he is the godchild.
Yeah, so I don't know. Maybe they have their own independent contractor grail guy that does this stuff at a cheaper rate. Because it seems to me like if you're going to drop a lot of money, you want something a little more, I don't know, aesthetically pleasing.
Yeah.
So your sunlight can shine through it. But that's just me.
Agreed.
Maybe I'm being judgy.
You are kind of, though.
It's in my nature, Steve. So this place is a buzz. I mean, there's people walking around. There's Grail soldiers passing through, talking to each other. They have custodians that even wear the Grail colors, cleaning up the place. So they are not only evil, but they're also very clean. And you got to appreciate good hygiene these days.
Got to.
It really is a plus. Yeah.
Impressive.
Hey, I don't know if they're having people take their shoes off when they walk in because they are in the desert. It could track a lot of dust in. But I appreciate the efforts because if you are going to walk around and track all that dust, at least they have custodians, right? And if there's two in this room, imagine how many there are.
I'm going 3.
You think? Masada's pretty big, man. I'm thinking 1 per level.
Wow. That place is a massive place, dude. You are not lying. Place is freaking humongous.
I wonder if those guys are on the payroll or if they have to 1099 it, Steve.
Very good question, Dan. Another logical question from a show such as this.
I'm going to put it on the list of things I ask if we get some interviews this season.
You will.
So as we're gazing at this beautiful hall, I think it's beautiful. I'm into that kind of thing. Featherstone tells Cass that this is Masada, the Grail's command station for 2,000 years and home to the child Messiah. As she does so, she kisses a crucifix because she's down like that. She's down with the Lord. Cass just says, Jesus. So they continue walking. She's giving him a tour, which is actually pretty nice because she could have just let him through. He doesn't know where he is. She wants him to be educated before she kills him.
Yes.
I like this part because as they're continuing to walking, we now see that Masada is really, really abuzz with activity. And not only activity, but commerce as well. They actually pass a coffee shop called Lazarus's Coffee. And if you look up at the sign, like I did, it resembles a Starbucks sign. I don't know exactly who was on there. I don't know if it was Humperdoo, but I don't think it was because that seemed like that would have been a little easier to catch. Perhaps it's Lazarus. Nonetheless, they have their own baristas there too. So you could be a Grail barista if you set your mind to it.
You know, I did not even realize that until I was like, what the crap is that behind them? I was like, is that like a Starbucks?
Yeah. You know, they have scones and crumb cakes and, you know, expensive bottled waters and protein.
And that is totally not Hairstar's idea. He would rather them be like, you guys don't have any amenities. You just be here in the dark with nothing.
I think he lost the debate or whatever with the upper heads who, you know, people love their coffee, Steve.
Totally.
I think that a golden opportunity was missed, by the way. I'm thinking that they should have shown some more businesses in the hallway. Maybe like a taco shack, maybe offering carne masada.
Oh, damn.
I know. I'm here all week, folks. Oh, it only gets better from here.
Woo!
You're just jealous because I thought of it.
You did think of it. That was carne masada is pretty interesting.
Just saying. They missed a golden opportunity. So anyway, back to these two crazy kids. I know it's terrible. Cass tells Featherstone to get him a latte, and he'll tell his friends to take it easy on her when they get there. She's like, no, thanks. But Cass tells her that Jesse has gotten his powers back. If you recall, he did get his powers back at the end of season three, and that sooner or later, he and Tulip will arrive. They will come for him. They're going to get him. Featherstone replies, good. Otherwise, why the hell would we need you? That's cold.
So good. And all this time, I'm noticing he's different. Like, he doesn't have his swag at all. I'm like, what is going on with Cass?
He's had a rough couple of months. You know, if you think about it, he was actually chopped up by Jesse at one point and stuffed in a box and sent off. You know, he's had a hell of a time. So I would be a little bitter, too.
Yeah, he's losing kind of often right
He's now. Losing.
He's not used to that. Yeah.
He's not living his best days right now.
No, he's not.
So Featherstone hurries him along as to not be late for class. That was immediately what I thought. It's like, where are they going? Because they seem like they're in a hurry. And we find out very soon. We see this sign. The sign reads, University of the Grail, established MCMLXV. Steve, any idea when that was established?
Say that one more time.
M like Mark, C.
Yes.
M like Mark, L, X, V like Victor.
Oh, dude, no. What about you? Do you have the cheat code?
It's 1965, baby.
Jeez, you're good at this.
So they took a long time. You know, if they've been around 2,000 years and they're just getting this University of the Grail established in 1965, what have they been doing beforehand?
I mean, that is a great question because, look, and were they integrated? That's what I want to know.
Maybe so.
I don't know, man.
Too many lighter shades up in there?
I didn't say anything. Go on. What were we talking about?
I was just wondering. You know what, though? In this, I think it's this scene. I meant to write a note about it, but I didn't. But there is one part where the hustle and bustle is going on and you see these different Grail people. There is a guy in the background. Black guy, Steve. Looks exactly like Hoover. Not Malcolm Barrett. Like Hoover from the comic.
Like Hoover from the comic.
Yeah. Same haircut. Everything. I don't know if that was just a little Easter egg or they just needed a brother in there and, you know, just to kind of fill up the space and make it look good or whatever. But he looks, coincidentally, he looks like Hoover.
Hey, of course. And I'm sure he got killed.
No, he's still alive, I think.
Is he really?
I mean, he could have gotten killed off camera somewhere, but no, I'm pretty sure he's still okay.
Exactly. He can't even get killed on camera. See how that goes?
Damn, that's wrong, people. Australia, we thought better of you until this point. You ever been to Australia, Steve?
I have, actually.
You have? Where'd you go? Was it Sydney?
I'm joking. No, I haven't gone to Australia.
Nah, when you go there, get some steak and eggs, mate.
Oh, wow. Is that their thing?
That's the only thing that I think I can say that sounds like an Australian, and it probably doesn't, but that's mine.
I can say murder. That's it.
How do you say
it? Murder.
Yeah, murder. It's hard to say.
I guarantee if Johnny Bucks is listening, he's like, ugh.
Give it a rest, mate. Johnny Bucks, that's a drop right there. If you guys are familiar, he's one of our very bestest friends, one of our very bestest listeners. Johnny Bucks, what's up? I'm just giving you a shout out because I know you're listening.
Yep, love you, man.
But back to this whole Grail classroom situation. So it seems that Grail has sort of become like a Hogwarts of sorts. The hallways are lined with lockers and classroom, and again, the hustle and bustle is going on. I never use that hustle and bustle, but it's coming out of my mouth today. I'm going to go with it.
Interesting.
As they're passing the various doors, we see these different signs that are placed, and it's one of them is beginning torture. Next one, intermediate torture. And you hear the cries again coming from the classroom. So now at least we know where those are coming from, but I'm still wondering where the first cries were coming from. Featherstone leads Cassidy into this room, and the sign reads Comparative French Literature. Not so bad, right? Lectured by Professor Coutard? Coutard? Probably not Coutard. That sounds terrible. Coutard? Who knows what the hell this guy's name is?
Wow.
However, Professor Coutard, that's what I'm going with. I imagine Cass would be like, okay, I'm going to go learn some French. But as they're entering the room, woman comes out, changes the sign to Advanced Torture. Guest lecturer, get ready, folks, Frankie Toscani.
Which is freaking amazing.
This is actually appropriate for him to be here. I think that you're going to hear us say over the course of this season, it's like, okay, well, this person's here. Why do you suppose that kind of thing? In this case, he's exactly where he's supposed to be at the exact time he's supposed to be. Frankie Toscani is a mafioso type, a torturer, a professional torturer that the mafia has worked with the Grail to get over there. And he does a hell of a job. We'll understand what he's doing a little bit later, just to say the least right now. I'm going to keep on going.
Oh, yes.
Did you even really have kind of an image of what you wanted him to look like? Because he's not the most significant character in the story.
I didn't have an idea of what I wanted him to look like. But when I saw him, I said, that is a perfect casting.
Right? Yeah, I think so too.
I even had to go back and say, hold on. And I looked it up. I'm like, yep, literally perfect. He has a little more oomph to him, a little more heft. I like that.
Right.
And I'm very eager to see if they do the Frankie the Eunuch thing. I don't know if they're going to show. They might, because they said, I mean, if we are to believe that Cassidy's going to do what he says he will, maybe we see.
Right. Him. Yeah, I think that we'll probably see something. I got a feeling. Cass is not going to leave him hanging. I said leave him hanging.
No, I like how you said that.
Because he is a character that I think a lot of people are very happy to see, I thought I would give him his own audio clip, Steve. And here we go.
The Lee Enfield rifle, named after its designer, James Paris Lee. You hear that? That click clunk? That's the sound of a 303 sliding into place, ready to fly. You want to talk to someone? First things first, you gotta earn their respect. Let me tell you something. There's few things more respectable than the Enfield.
Boom, Frankie shoots Cassidy. I think he's going to be one of the many things that he does to him. And I think you'll find out what those things are very soon. But for now, we're going to cut. We're going to go to a bar. We're having a full-on bar fight. And it's all between Grail soldiers. So they're getting drunk. They're yucking it up. They're fighting each other. Kind of like being in the Navy or something like that, I think. Though I've never been in the Navy. No offense, sailors.
Shame on you.
So we're not really sure where they are. But we find out very soon because we see the exterior of the place. And the sign reads, Holy Bar and Grail Motel. That's a great play on words.
That is a very, very great play on words.
And yes, ladies and gentlemen, there's vacancy. As the fight rages on, one Grail soldier decides to stand up, removes his beret, and he begins to sing.
I did not understand this at all.
Yeah, I'm not entirely sure what's going on, but I'll tell you this, Steve. That guy could be in Book of Mormon. Like, for real. He looks like the lead in Book of Mormon.
Here's my thing. I think what I was thinking ended up playing out. Like, what the hell is going on here? What happens next is also someone else being like, this looks ridiculous.
Yeah.
And so I'm like, oh, good. We're not the only ones.
I have another audio clip for you because I thought I would back up my statement about this guy being Book of Mormon. Steve, let's listen to his golden tones.
Let's do it.
Listen. The sky will be bathed in a glorious light. The world, his vision will come true. Cleansed are the sinners, not a heretic in sight. Together we will start anew.
So at the back of the bar, we see Jesse and Tulip, who've been watching this whole thing going down. They're slightly confused, slightly amused. They have this look on their face, like they're sort of enjoying it in a weird way. Jesse has yanked the cord from the jukebox, and all the music stops, because that's what happens when you yank a cord from a jukebox, and they all stop singing. Tulip tells them that their dick of a boss has kidnapped their friend, and they want him back. She then asks them, who wants to help break him out of Masada? You know, they need the help, so who's going to help them get him out? They simultaneously pull out their guns and point them at Jesse and Tulip. And Jesse, of course, uses the word and tells them, freeze. Jesse uses the word a second time, Steve, and tells them, she's your boss. You work for her. Which, of course, they all repeat back to Jesse in unison. So Tulip's like, all right, bitches, let's go. We cut to our first shot of the Saint of Killers from there, Steve.
I love that he said, are you sure you want to do this? I was like, why wouldn't she be sure?
Maybe he's given her the courtesy because, if you recall, she did have some qualms with him using the word.
That's true.
But at this point, they have to get in there and get Cassidy. So
they do.
It would be kind of weird, wouldn't you think, if she said, nah, don't do that. We'll just do it the old-fashioned way. I believe in getting things done quickly, and this seems to be the quickest avenue to drive down, Steve, to get the results.
I believe it.
But like I was saying, we got our first shot of the Saint of Killers this season. He's looking good. Probably needs to bathe. But I don't really think he gives a shit about that kind of thing. He's standing in front of this burned, crumbling building. What the building is actually the estate of Grandma Marie Langelle. That place got burnt to the ground for the most part last season. Next to Santa Killers, of course, is Eugene. He tells Eugene, he says, he's moved on. And Eugene replies,
where?
Which means cool, where?
That was really good, actually.
Oh, thank you.
Wow.
The Saint tells him it doesn't matter. He can't hide. They're going to get him eventually. He turns and he walks away as Eugene follows him. Now, we're going to go back to Masada, Steve. We're going to be doing a lot of back and forth in these next two episodes. I'm just telling you right now, folks, so strap in. We're back in advanced torture, and Frankie has been taking shots at Cassidy and just calling out body parts as he shoots him. He's like, kidney, bam, knee, bam, and last but not least, the liver. Shoots Cass in the liver, and Cass obviously screams in pain. Mm-hmm. But of course, he says, God damn it, I got a drink with that. Frankie's explaining to the class that the usual person would bleed out at this point because there's only so many body parts they can lose.
True.
However, he says that Cass is different. He's the anomaly because these things just grow right back. And we actually see some proof of that. We've seen it before, but it definitely helps his story. And we see a bullet wound closing underneath Cass's t-shirt. Frankie goes on to explain that in a case like this, you got to go old school with the application of pain, Steve. You know what I mean?
You know this. I mean, who doesn't?
Yeah, I mean, it's commonplace in my house. You know what I'm saying?
Of course, silly goose, you.
So Frankie puts on this plastic apron, the kind of apron that you see at the butcher shop, the kind that you can just wipe down real quick so you know something's going down. And he opens up this box that all torture artists, I should say, mm-hmm. they all seem to have this box, their little magic torture box, right? So he opens up this box and he holds up this tool. And getting back to the old school thing, he tells the class, you gotta go Bensonhurst. Now, Steve, I'm not exactly sure what he meant by Bensonhurst. I don't recall it being in the comic, but I can tell you that it is in Brooklyn. And it would seem okay. to me that Frankie's from Brooklyn. So maybe okay. he's just like, you know, you got to go back to the hood. You got to go back to the neighborhood and show these people how it's done.
Okay.
That's what I'm thinking.
Maybe.
And people love Brooklyn. I guarantee if you were in an audience right now, like, you know, I don't know, Jimmy Fallon or something like that, and someone said something about Brooklyn, you hear Brooklyn in the back.
Oh, so people, there's no question.
You know what I'm saying? So no maybe question. It's like just this, it's like Brooklyn pride. That's what I'm going with.
You've been in New York. You've been to Brooklyn?
I have not been to Brooklyn, Steve. I was in New York. But we never crossed over the bridge. And I was really sad, too, because apparently right underneath the bridge, folks, there's a pizza place that's to die for. Stop. However, if you ask anybody in New York where the best place to eat pizza is, they're going to tell you wherever they say is the place to go where, you know, the this pizza's to die for.
This is very
But
true.
Brooklyn, apparently right off the bridge, from you're going from Manhattan to Brooklyn, right there, as you get off the bridge, there's good pizza, folks. Don't say I never did anything for you. So Cass is toying with Frankie, and he calls him Fredo just to talk a little shit to him. He tells him to come, come a little bit closer. And he explains that he's been tortured so many times that there's really nothing that he could do to him that hasn't been done already. Hundreds of times. But Frankie gets a little creative, and he pulls out a yarmulke, Steve. So
wow.
I don't think he's an Italian Jew. I think that he just wants to be symbolic with this. And you know where this was going, if you're paying attention, because he's about to perform a bris. Yeah.
Of course.
There was no rabbi there. I don't know if he was playing both parts. So Frankie with the yarmulke on now is like, oh, yeah, nothing. He flips a switch that lowers his position. Like he literally just drops down to Cassidy's crotch level. We all, like I said, we all know where this is going. And the circumcision begins. Cass is screaming in agony. I mean, nothing. Not a shot of Novocaine.
Jeez,
nothing.
Louise, dude.
It's hard times, man.
Yeah. I see what you did there, too.
I didn't even mean to on that
one. Oh, you should have taken it. Well, then wait, dude, you should have just taken it.
Okay, I'll take it.
Yes.
I'll take it. Thank you. As the circumcision begins, we get this perfectly timed overhead shot of Hairstar, who's standing at the Masada balcony, is what I'm going to call it. The same balcony that we saw him in the last scene of season three, where he's looking at the binoculars.
Mm-hmm.
Reaches his hand up and he pats his head. If you guys will recall, he received a pretty unique scar. I'll say that.
Yeah.
To say the least. Right across this dome. And spoilers, folks, if you don't read the comic, now basically the top of his head looks like the head of a penis. So it's kind of funny. Probably not for Star.
And it annoys the piss out of him.
And what annoys him more, if you'll recall, is that Jesse used the word on him and said, you can't wear hats anymore,
yep.
bitch.
Yep.
So that's messed up. But he probably had it coming. I know he had it coming. He's Hair Star.
Had it coming. I see what you did there.
Now you're really pushing it now. I mean, you're really, this is like low-hanging fruit at this point, Steve. And that's the thing. I'm going to foul myself up enough. You know what I'm saying? I'm going to say enough stupid stuff myself. You're just throwing these in and adding to it. But that's okay.
I'm just saying you're killing it.
They're funny. I like them.
Thank you. I'm not saying much. So what I do say, you know, I'm trying to kill it.
You're going for quality, not quantity.
It bingo.
I like it. So Star's standing there, and Featherstone comes out to meet him, and she informs him that Frankie is working on Cass at that moment, and she asks if there's been any sign of Custer. So Hairstar's looking through his binoculars, and he's just going, and that's when we see Jesse's silhouette. He's walking towards Masada, and the sun sets behind him. It's kind of a beautiful shot, actually.
He really is.
Star lowers his binoculars, and he exclaims, he's here. And a guard manning a huge gun has Jesse in his crosshairs. I don't even know. We're not gun people. We have no idea. I don't think I know what this gun is called, Steve. I don't know if you do, but it's a big ass gun. And he's basically following him. He's got Jesse in the crosshairs as he's approaching the gates of Masada or the door of Masada.
And he is so happy that Jesse's coming.
Well, now he's got like some vengeance to fulfill. You know what I mean? He wants him there because he knows that he can get pleasure out of the revenge.
But isn't it dope that Jesse is like not even tripping? He's just walking. He's like, whatever, G. I just don't have time for this silliness. Let's get this over with.
He gives zero crap, Steve.
Yep.
So I thought this was kind of funny. There's a guard standing at the entrance of Masada. And it's just this big wide entrance. There's nothing else there. But there's this stupid, you know, the little threshold thing that you walk through that's a metal detector. Mm-hmm. Kind of lame. I thought that was funny. I think it was meant to be that way. But, you know, because you could just walk right around it. But it's Preacher. We don't argue about those things. And again, I think I'm nitpicking. Jesse walks through the metal detector and it goes off, steps away. He removes his fuck communism Zippo that he retrieved back from Jody in season 3. And he's able to pass through finally. Star's watching all of this from the balcony.
Everyone is thinking he is up to something. So everyone's on edge. Every move he makes... And he's just like, and he like puts his hands up and is like, hey, listen, I'm just trying to come in. That's it. Sorry, it's my Zippo. My fault. I was like, oh, yeah. Jesse is so
cool. Calm down,
cool,
everybody.
Right? Everybody chill. I'm just coming in, chilling. I thought it was so funny.
Jesse doesn't play around with guns that much, though. You know, he's a bare hands kind of guy.
We'll see that very soon.
So Hairstar tells Featherstone to let Jesse in, and she waves this big red flag. If you're an Iron Maiden fan, it's kind of Bruce Dickinson-y. If you're not, let's move on. It's not that important.
So most of you don't know what he's talking about. Go on.
I don't know, Steve. We'll get that's for another time. But I think more people than you think. So she's waving this flag in the air, and that's the cue. Will you stop? And that's the cue for some guy to open up the Masada doors. And Jesse goes in. This guard leads Jesse to Hairstar directly to him, who's now surrounded by all these guards. And they all have these noise-canceling headphones on. So I'm going to paint this picture just a little bit. They're standing in, I guess it's Hairstar's quarters. I'm not sure if it's like the official quarters for the Allfather or what. But on the wall, you see various pictures of Allfather's past. So anyway, Star's standing there, and he's got the guards around him. And they all, like I said, they all have these noise-canceling headphones on because if they hear the word, then it's all over, right? They're going to lose.
Yes.
So Star's all speaking loudly because of it. And Jesse comments on this elderly lady that's in the room with him. She's totally out of place. Star explains that's the sign language interpreter in case Jesse gets feisty. Jesse tells him the only idea he has is freeing Cassie. That's it. And at that time, we cut to Cassidy, who's continuously getting circumcised over and over again. So this guy has got like rapid grow back because, you know, there's only so much foreskin you can take. But apparently it's enough to where Frankie can cut the foreskin. It flies off into a bucket and he's right back to business again. That's a lot of foreskin trimming, Steve.
Dude, okay, here's the thing. I think for me, if I knew I was just going to regrow something, it would hurt, but it would be a different sort of hurt. Can I ask you a question that's going to take 1 minute?
Absolutely.
So let's imagine, if you will, okay? Imagine if you will. There's a situation of you're just going to feel the pain of your hand getting cut off and actually won't have your hand getting cut off. I think the pain is less than we think it is. I think the idea that your hand is getting cut off is the big thing. I think if you just felt the pain, you'd be like, oh, ouch. But it wouldn't be like, oh, in my brain, my hand getting cut off would have hurt way more than that. But I think the idea of your brain saying we're missing a limb actually elevates the pain. What do you think?
You know, I buy that.
I think so.
It's a bit of a physiological thing that we're talking about.
I think it'd be like, oh, it hurts, but technically it's not as much pain as I thought it would be for an amputated hand. But I think it's really dope how they're doing this. He's freaking out, but he's not going as crazy as any of us would go because he knows technically I'm going to get it back. But this really sucks.
But it seems like he's in some pretty good agony.
But he's not like screaming and pulling at the rope. He's not like, ah, ah. He's just like, oh, so, like he's screaming. But he's like, I know it's just going to come back though.
I present an idea right now.
Huh?
Why don't you go ahead and cut the tip of your pinky off right now on mic? And we'll see what you think.
Dan.
Just a thought, Steve.
Tell you what, if I get bit and become a vampire that is indestructible, I will do whatever you... I'd be like, hey, cut off your leg. I'm like, sure, I'll just grow it back. Yeah, no problem.
I think you're all talk, Hudson.
I will walk and try to find the walkers of the night tonight and try to find one that is attracted to my amazing neck. I guess it would be harder to find one that isn't.
This is probably true. He's got a lovely neck, people.
It's true.
I've never said it on mic before, but it's true.
Not on mic? So you've said that to like Gail or something?
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. I say it all the time. I'm just saying I never put it out there to the public. I tell people all the time. I'll just say, hey, man, let me show you something. I'll just pull up your picture, your Facebook picture. Look at this guy's neck. They're like, that is a really nice neck. I'm like, I told you. That's why I'm showing you.
I know your wife's like, enough with the Steve's neck already.
Like, he talks about my chest, so I have to talk about
your
neck.
Chest is incredible.
Thank you, sir. Now, remember, this conversation between Jesse and Star is going on. We cut back to Star, and he tells him he's resting, meaning Cass. Jesse then tries to kind of rationalize with Star a little bit, and he's like, you know, he knows he's mad at him for making the head scar. It's not Cassidy. It's him. He's trying to get, you know, take the blame. Like, leave my friend alone. It's not him. It's me. He makes a peace offering. He tosses a baseball cap to him. It was a red baseball cap. You know where my head went immediately. Of course, that wasn't the case at all. And I was glad about that. And he tells him that if he lets him go, he can wear hats again. That's a pretty juicy offer, if you're a hair star. Who has no hair? And it's not spelled H-A-I-R. So I don't know why I said it. But after some consideration, Steve, Star refuses. And I have an audio clip, because we haven't heard his lovely voice yet.
Nice try, Custer. But I had a different idea when I took your friend and lured you here. Don't you want to know?
What is your very different idea, Klaus?
You're here, Jesse Custer, to have a giant vagina carved into your head.
I see. That's how you want to play it.
Jesse does, in fact, want to play it that way, and he actually cues one of the Grail guards to start shooting. Now, remember, they're all working for Tulip, so this was just this big ruse to get in there, but he had these people on his side the entire time. As this gunfight's going on, Jesse's smart. He sneaks out, basically, and uses the word on another guard. Take me to Cassidy. We cut to Tulip, who's arriving at the entrance of Masada, and she's kind of pulling that old... Now, again, I'm using a lot of references from pop culture. Steve, I don't imagine you're going to get this one, but folks... Everyone else in the world that has seen Star Wars, she's pulling that old Chewbacca in handcuffs routine. You know what I mean? It makes her look like she's incapacitated, but that's not the case at all. Star Wars A New Hope, ladies and gentlemen. Check it out. Word podcast pick of the week. So she's being walked along by a female guard who's way too agreeable. And I don't know if you caught this or not, but that guard really resembled Whitney Cummings to me. She had a real Whitney Cummings thing going
on. You know what? She did. Now that I'm thinking about it, she has the long face.
Well, wow. All right, judgy, but I'm just saying she looks like Whitney Cummings.
I'm saying they have an elongated punim.
It was a cheekbone thing.
That too.
Yeah, okay. Anyway, she looks like her.
Both very pretty people.
Oh, nice back pedal.
I'm just saying they are.
You need to put a little WD-40 on those gears, because I heard you back pedaling. We do yet another cut, and we're back in the torture hall, and Cass is still strung up, but this time he actually is resting, and Jesse enters the room. Cass calls him a wanker for taking so long. And Jesse looks at Frankie's work and he's like, and by work, I mean, you know, Cass's crotch, of course. And he asks what happened. Kind of a stupid question if you think about it. Cass tells him that about the multiple circumcisions, and Jesse asks who did it to him. But from behind him, we hear, who's asking, asshole?
And also Jesse almost laughs.
He looked kind of amused.
Yeah. And he's like, are you laughing? And Jesse was like, no. And then he says something else and he's like, there you go laughing again. I'm like, oh, something's up with Cassidy, dude.
Yeah, he's got a chip on his shoulder.
Yeah, he has a big... Jesse did giggle when he found out what was going on. He did giggle, and he's like, are you laughing at me? And it seemed like it really hurt Cassidy. Like, it hurt his feelings.
He's sensitive. He's been circumcised multiple times.
And he really thinks that, like, the Cassidy of old could have just gotten out there to be like, oh, I'll just kill these people. No problem. And it didn't work like that. And what's about to go down shows who's the man right now.
So when he hears who's asking asshole... He turns around and this big fight begins and Jesse and the guards go at it. Now, folks, if you're new to Preacher or perhaps you've just watched it once and you haven't paid as much crazy attention as I have, we do know one thing, and there are some amazing fights in Preacher, and this is one of those fights. So Jesse's just kicking ass. He's fighting all the Grail officers, and once he's done with them, he moves on to Frankie. They start fighting. Frankie's losing some blood, and I do believe some teeth, but I could be wrong about that. There's this one shot where he hits him, and something flies out. I think it's teeth, but who knows? Well, I guess we'll find out. Cass is watching the whole thing, and he seems genuinely disturbed by the joy that Jesse's getting from the fight. Did you notice that?
Yes.
Like, Jesse's smiling as he's hitting people, and Cass is like, Jesus, man. Like, it really makes me wonder where he's at. I think he just has a completely different opinion of Jesse now.
What I took from it was he's, like, stepping on his quote-unquote plan, and B, being, like, he loves this. And Cassie was like, wow, he really likes doing this. He likes hurting right. people. But it's also, and you're stepping on my plan just doing the Jesse hurting people thing. I had another way to go with this. I think Cass might also just be tired of killing people. He just might be tired of it.
It's a lot.
It is.
If you hang out with Jesse, it's a lot. There's a lot of death following.
It is.
And you got to keep in mind that Cass has to do this from time to time anyway. You know, you get sick potato chips. You eat the same potato chips all the time. You get sick of them. You want something different, right?
That's true.
Once Frankie's unconscious, Steve, Jesse frees Cass, who tells him that he had everything under control and that he was just looking for that weakness, that right moment, right? And Jesse asks Cass if he wants to do his vampire thing, you know, rip off their head, suck their blood. And again, he kind of looks disgusted with him. Like, why would I do that? He looks at Jesse and he gives him that look like, why would you say that? And he just tells him, I'm good. I don't know.
Yes.
He's not liking Jesse. I think Jesse would have been like if Jesse would have said, hey, man, let's go and pet some puppies or something. He would have found something bad about that, too. I think he just doesn't really. He's happy to be free, but he's super pissed at Jesse.
Yes, he's not. I mean, like, I don't know what's going on with him. I really genuinely don't. But something is happening with him. I don't know what it is, though. They don't really go into it.
Now, back at Masada's entrance, all the guards are going through the metal detector because, you know, they have to follow protocol. And the guard manning the door tells the female guard to go upstairs to operations and fill out an incident report. But being that she's still under the spell of the word, she blatantly refuses.
Nice work. Going up to operations and fill out an incident report.
No, I won't.
You got something better to do.
Yeah. Secure the exit and waste anyone that gets in our way.
What the hell has gotten into you?
I don't like it either, Tam, but filing reports is part of the job, so it'll take a few minutes.
Don't give a shit how long it takes, Sarge. I'm not doing it.
Soldier, you work for me, and you will damn well do what I say.
No, I work for her now.
Another gunfight breaks out. Tulip tells the female guard, who I believe her name is Tommy. I should give her a name because I shouldn't just call her a female guard. I believe they called her Tommy in this. Could be wrong. She tells Tommy to man the door, which she replies, on it, boss. Like, super agreeable, right? So Tommy gets to this gigantic mechanized door. She's over there struggling as the door's closing around her, kind of like trash compactor style in Star Wars again. Yes, I did another Star Wars reference,
Steve. That.
And Tulip asks her how she's doing, but the door is too much for her to hold it open. And she's just crushed between the door and the wall. We hear this like crunching sound, this kind of squelching sound. All of her innards are all over the place.
As soon as Tulip said, keep that door open, I knew what was going to happen.
Yeah, I kind of saw it coming too. Yeah. But it was still pretty good. I liked it.
It's fun.
I don't believe it. You had fun. I think that you're just sort of saying it for the sake of the show.
I'm serious.
I don't know, man.
Come on.
But that's okay.
Come on.
I'm just saying, dude. It didn't seem sincere. A little more oomph next time, Hudson.
Okay, done deal.
So we cut back to Jesse and Cass, who are still making their escape out of this place, but they're still bickering with each other as well. And Jesse's blaming Cass for getting into trouble in the first place, but Cass is blaming his troubles on Jesse's bullshit because really, if it wasn't for all this chasing God stuff, Cass would be living a different life, completely different life. So I kind of side with Cass in this. It's all Jesse's fault.
I would be very mad at Jesse right now. Because there is a million different things that could have gone right. He's like, we could walk away right now and go to Bimini today. But no, Jesse has some weird mission he's on. And the woman he loves keeps following him. So that means that he has to follow her.
Right.
Yep.
He's a little territorial.
Mm-hmm.
Jesse gives Cassie a little bit of shit about being a Boy Scout and crossing old ladies across the street and everything like that. In other words, oh, you're Mr. Innocent now? And Cass is like, well, I wasn't getting my penis shaved off. Let's put it that way. Cassie asks Jesse if he has any Percocets. And Jesse again sarcastically answers him that he forgot the Percocets. And Cassidy's like, why would anyone bring a torture victim painkillers? Good point. But then again, he didn't know.
That's true.
He didn't know. As they're making their way out, they come to this dead end and they find that they have to shoot their way out because these guards are now there again. And Jesse just, this is how I took it. I'm not entirely sure if this is how it went down, but I watched it a couple of times. It seemed to me that Cass was acting as a human shield as Jesse was fighting his way out. So he was shooting. So I guess he does shoot. He doesn't always like, you know, just throw dukes, but I think he was shooting and Cassidy was his human shield. Did you get that? Did you see this at all? Is it not that important?
I didn't see that, but it's possible.
Outside, we see the carnage from Tulip's gun battle, and Tulip is surprised by Tommy, who's miraculously still alive. She's basically cut in half, though. Kind of like that scene in Signs. Remember that?
Yes.
Remember that with Mel Gibson's wife?
Yeah, that's unfortunate. That is, why would you bring up such a sad scene?
I mean, it'll ruin your day, but I was just trying to compare it to something.
Swing away.
Quick audio clip of Tommy meeting her fate. Here we go.
Are you okay, boss? Jesus.
Are you okay?
Fine. Stings a little. Remember the mission, boss. If Jerry and Cass are gonna get out, we need this door open and kept open.
It's Jesse. Well, then they're screwed.
No, you just gotta throw the switch open.
There's a switch that opens the door? There's a door switch?
Well,
where the hell is it?
Don't worry, boss. We got this.
Shit.
So with that little bit of information, Tulip now knows that she has to get to the door button. And she's going to have to climb this mountainside of Masada. It's a really good thing that she's Tulip, because I really couldn't see a lot of people going through with this. But it's Tulip, and we're going to get what we want. Back inside of Masada, Jesse and Cass are still fighting their way out. And Cass is all vamped up this time, though. And he's, like, killing soldiers, and he's, like, biting their necks and shit like that. But the bickering's getting ridiculous at this point, Steve. They're bickering about who pressed the elevator button first.
Yeah.
Who's seen the slowest elevator before. It's ridiculous. Mm-hmm. But these guys, it's Cassidy and Jess, and they're not happy with each other right now. We cut to Tulip, who's climbing this mountainside very easily, by the way. No gear or anything. She's like free soloing it.
Free solo. That's pretty impressive, Jay. I didn't even know you'd know about that, but that's what I thought about when she was doing it.
I've seen some films. I believe I told you to watch that one.
You didn't see it before me.
Okay, now we're doing the whole Jesse Cassidy.
Okay, sorry. Go on. She's climbing.
Kind of ridiculous. We're being petty at this point.
Yes. Petty Pendergrass. It's true.
Old Petty Pendergrass. That's you. We cut back into this all-father room, as I'm calling it, and we see Hairstar, who has buried himself underneath all these guards, the fallen guards from the gunfight, as well as the interpreter. It looks like he used her as a human shield, and that's total par for Star. When he gets to his feet, the right headphone shorts out. I thought at first that he was shot, but it actually shorts out. And when he removes the headphones, he sees that he has lost his right ear. His right ear has been completely amputated. So we now know, comic lovers, that at least they're giving us a nod to the misadventures of Hairstar and his missing body parts. And I think that's pretty cool. I liked it. Now, this is something I didn't get. Star looks over and he sees these papers under a paperweight, and they're like blowing from this mysterious breeze. I thought they were going to come back to it. I don't think they did, but they're definitely alluding to something. Cutting back again to Jesse and Cass. Jesse now wants a thank you, Steve. And Cass is telling him that his foreskins could never repay him enough.
That is great, so funny.
Oh, yeah. Thanks, buddy. My 900 foreskins that were cut. Just really, really happy that you're here.
Yes. You were on the late show, G. But you know what? He should have apologized still, and he wouldn't. He should have apologized because he was betting on him coming. And he ended up showing. And now he doesn't want to apologize. I'm like, what is Cass's deal?
I think he's being Tom Petty in the Heartbreakers.
I think so, dude. Yeah. I think he's being Petty Player One.
I think he's being Petty Rubbles, dude.
Oh, that's right.
When Tulip eventually reaches the top of Masada, she finds this guard that's sitting there reading a newspaper, old school style, like the guys at the shoeshine places.
Uh-huh.
It's all up in the face. And Tulip pulls a gun out and says, I'm sorry, but I'm going to need you to open that door. newspaper lowers, and who is it, Steve? It's Featherstone. And she's like, don't be sorry, bitch. And they get to it. They both fire their guns at the same time. I thought this was kind of a cool
scene. So dope, dude.
They fire their guns at the same time, and they're both astounded, jaw-droppingly astounded, when they look down and they see that their bullets hit head-on and have formed this little metal mesh that has fallen in the ground between them. They look at it for a while, and they both say, cool, at the same time, and the fight rages
on. I love that they are so similar.
Oh, yeah.
In different ways, and they look, and they're like, cool. And they're like, oh, snap, that's right, we don't like
it. In another life, these two would be best friends.
Oh, there's no question.
We get back over to the entrance again, and Cass and Jess are still arguing, man. I think you get the point. They're just arguing like crazy. They're behind the entrance door where Tommy is crushed. So they're arguing next to a half of a person, basically.
I can't believe you're still pissed about that.
But you cut me into pieces and tried to mail me. Not even first class, neither. Don't think I didn't notice that.
I was trying to help.
You were trying to be the hero, just like you are doing now. It's your bloody kick, all right? You like making people do the things you think is best.
I'm sorry, I thought it best that you're not burning alive, Cass.
I can tell you now.
Maybe next time I won't make that mistake.
It's not just me neither, you know? It's Tulip too.
Leave her out of it.
Do you think I chose this?
Like I'm actually enjoying being in love with her.
We're not going to talk about her ever again. You understand? Not one more word.
Tulip.
So boom, Steve. Shots fired. Cass has now admitted to Jesse that he's been in love with Tulip. He didn't really say how long, but I think that the message was clear.
I mean, he knew it.
Sure.
Yeah.
Jesse knew.
He just needed the fact that he said it is like, oh.
But it always stings a little bit because no one wants to hear the truth, right?
No.
Back on the roof, or the top of Masada, I should say, Tulip and Featherstone are still getting it on. And Featherstone punches Tulip, and she falls off of the cliff. And they're like, oh, no, Tulip's going to die. But it's Tulip, so we know she's okay.
Of course.
And Featherstone tells her, that'll teach you to sucker punch me. Last season she's referring to. She got sucker punched by the swamp. We look down, though, see, and like I said, no one worries about these types of things when it's Tulip. And she is hanging, much like something you would see in pretty much any Wile E. Coyote situation.
Yes.
The Roadrunners.
Yeah.
You know, there's always that large root that's sticking out of the mountain.
Mm-hmm.
So she's hanging onto that with a lawn chair, you know, because when you're hanging off the side of a mountain, holding onto a large root, that's what you do, right?
Yeah.
I mean, it makes total sense. She makes her way back up super quick, by the way, and the fight continues on. Tulip gets the upper hand and now has Featherstone hanging over the ledge, kind of like a Suge Knight style.
Mm-hmm.
Tulip asks her, uncle? Featherstone's like, blow me. Tulip's like, I'll do it. And Featherstone tells her, I'll die a martyr, slain at the hand of a disbelieving moron. So Tulip lets her go and she falls. And I love this part because mid-fall, Featherstone goes into full-on dive mode.
Which is baffling. This is baffling, Tulip. When she's like, why is she diving? Is she like excited?
I thought it was great, man. I'd love to. I know I saw that look on her face, like, what the hell? But Featherstone goes into full on dive, spreads her legs and arms, and like her suit turns into like, I don't know exactly what they're called. It's like a glider suit, perhaps. It looks like flying squirrel, essentially.
Yeah.
And she just glides off to safety. I thought that was super
cool. It was really
dope.
Cool.
I loved it.
It was really cool.
Tulip's watching her, and you can tell she clearly respects this move. Like, oh shit, I wish I would have done that. Again, like these two are meant for each other. They just never will line up.
Nope. Because she was like, I'm willing to kill you. That kind of makes a point. Both of them are willing to kill each other, but like you said, in another universe, they'd be homies.
Totally. Tulip finds this giant lever. She opens the door. And at the door, Cass and Jesse are still going on about their business. The door starts to open, and what's left of Tommy just goes to the floor. And Jesse makes the leave. Like, he's out. It's time. Let's dip. But Cass, for some reason, stays behind. And Jesse's like, oh, you need my jacket for the sun? And Cass, he doesn't move. He just sits there. And Jesse's like, you know, you're free. And he's like wondering what this is all about. And Cass tells him, I told you, I got this. Cass hears Shalom from behind him and turns around and he finds Frankie and two guards. So Cass doesn't have shit. Jesse's walking away and he's like totally confused. And again, we see him in the crosshairs of this rooftop guard that he's about to get shot. As the guard's pulling the trigger, Hairstar tells him to hold his fire. He then says, not yet. As he holds a handkerchief to the hole where his freaking ear used to be. So you know that he wants him to suffer. He wants this to be done on his terms. He doesn't want him just to, you know, shoot him in the back like a coward. He wants him to really, really feel this pain. From here, we go to the Holy Bard and Grail again. And Tulip and Jesse have now met back up, and they're standing under this sign that reads, Welcome back, you gobshite.
makes no sense. I got this?
That's what he said.
Uh-uh. Don't make no sense, Jesse.
What exactly about Cassidy does make sense?
What's that supposed to mean? Did something happen? Did you two fight?
Not really.
What happened? Jesse Custer, what did you do?
Nothing. I got him right there to the door, but I tried. I swear.
Well, does he know I'm here? Did he ask about me? So we go again. Drag his dumb ass out of there if we have to. It's gonna be tough. They'll really be expecting us this time. Hey, I still got that Grail suit, remember? From Japan? How about
you sleep with him?
What?
Cassidy, you sleep with him.
Excuse me, did I?
I won't be mad. I promise. Just tell me. Did you sleep with him?
No. Okay?
Tomorrow we go again.
So now it's nighttime, and Jesse and Tulip are lying in bed. And as Tulip sleeps, Jesse awakens to the sound of explosions. He goes to the window and he looks out and he sees what I suppose is like a vision of the apocalypse. You see this large phallic looking rock help me out, Steve. Mushroom cloud is the word I'm looking for.
Yes.
Going up behind him. It looks like the apocalypse is going down right now. Suddenly the phone rings and Jesse goes to it. And he answers it. And it's Jesse's father on the line. And he tells him, it's time to get to work. It's time to find God. But Jesse needs to hurry because big things are coming for him is what he gets told. And Jesse suddenly wakes up. It's one of those ones where you wake up from the dream, you know, and you find out that all is well and everything. He looks out the window. There's no apocalypse going on. And suddenly Herr Star appears and is trying to chloroform Jesse. And this is where it gets a little crazy. So they start struggling and, you know, they're fighting. Jesse gets the upper hand and he flips Herr Star over and he kisses him on the lips. No, I'm just kidding. He flips Herr Star over and he starts to strangle him. Wouldn't that be crazy if he did that? I think it would
be
funny.
That would be hilarious.
But he's strangling him. And then suddenly he wakes up. I'm glad I've never done this before because, you know, he's waking up and he's strangling the love of his life. Tulip's there. She has no air left in her. And he finds he's like unable to stop. So he uses the word on himself to stop. For whatever reason, he was not allowed to stop. And Tulip speaks, but in Jesse's word voice this time. And she tells him, no more dreaming. This is your wake up call. And then Jesse sits up real quick in bed, now finally awake, and he was doing a dream within a dream. From there, we see Jesse seated at this side table, little desk, you know, in the hotels, mm-hmm. and he's writing this letter to the still sleeping Tulip. He places this letter at her bedside, and he just dips. He leaves Tulip behind.
This guy, man.
Well, I think in this case, though, I think he's trying to keep her safe is really all it is. I mean, he just woke up from a dream where he was strangling her. So maybe he's like, you know what? For once, I'm just going to leave and keep her away from the trouble. But he's not giving her the credit she deserves because he knows that she's just going to follow him. So from there, we cut to Cassidy, who's being beaten by Frankie, just getting the shit beat out of him. And Frankie finally leaves the room. And the Archangel, who's hanging up, is watching this whole thing. He's hanging above him, and he's watching this whole thing going down. We then see Tulip, who's reading this letter that Jesse left her. And she goes to the closet. She opens up the closet, and she spreads those clothes apart. And what does she find? She finds that Marnie outfit, the Grail outfit, her costume. Cut back to Jesse, who's walking down the road, and this truck passes him, and he hitches a ride with this truck. And by the way, guys, I know this is choppy, but it's just going back and forth and back and forth, and I'm just literally telling you what's going on. We go to Herr Star, who sits at his desk, and Featherstone tells him that she's going to accept any punishment for the screw-up that she did, any punishment he sees fit. And he just tells her to get out, and she leaves kind of upset. You know, I think she wants more attention from him, and he was just so, like, nonchalant about it. He's like, I don't even want to deal with you right now. Just get out. So she leaves. She's a little bit butthurt. Star's touching his ear, or I should say the hole where his ear used to be. And again, this little unknown breeze comes through and it's moving the papers. And I don't know what's up with that yet. I thought maybe it's because she left the room and let a draft in, but I don't think that they would go there. They're doing this for a certain reason. Perhaps God, I don't know.
Yeah.
At this point, Herr Star gets up and he goes to fix himself a drink, but it's not for him. He brings the drink over to someone who's seated in a chair. And when the camera pans to that person, we see that it's God. So again, maybe this has to do with the whole blowing of the breeze thing, I think that has something to do with it. I think it's God. God's like admiring this drink in his hand. He says, ah, one of my greatest creations. And Herostar's like, you better be right about this. God tells him, I'm right about everything.
He's right, you know.
I mean, who's going to argue with him, right?
Exactly.
Star's lamenting that he had Jesse in his bare hands, man. He had him dead to rights. And God counters with, but you didn't want him dead to rights, Star. You wanted him to suffer. And Star's like, yeah, you're right.
Good point.
You got a point. Sorry, God. You are always right.
That's hilarious.
So God tells him, so let's make him suffer. And we have now gotten through episode one.
Yes.
Masada. How are we doing, Steve?
This was effective. That was a really good, I mean, wow, Dan.
I think you guys are going to find out very soon that we go all over the place with this show, but it's almost impossible to do with the time we have. So it is a straightforward show this time around. We hope you're enjoying it, ladies and gentlemen. Let's get down to breakdown two, Steve. Episode two, Last Supper.
Let's do it.
Written by Gary Tiche, T-I-E-C-H-E. I believe it's Tiche. And directed by John Grillo. And I really like this, how it starts, because it's sort of reminiscent of the first, very first episode. We get this interesting scene that takes us back to the prehistoric times. And we see God, who's admiring his latest creation, the Brontosaurus. He's looking at him. He's like, my greatest creation. And to his disgust, the Brontosaurus drops a big old deuce right in front of him. Just splat.
Mm-hmm.
God kind of grimaces, you know, like, ugh. And he turns his head and he looks. And I'm thinking this is a like an older meme kind of a thing, because he points at, he sees a double rainbow. He's like, double rainbow. And he points at it. So Preacher went to about, what was it? Like, what would you say? 2005, maybe?
Yeah, something probably. Like that. Yeah.
They pulled it out of the hat. The Brontosaurus then moves towards the steaming turd, and God attempts to stop him from doing what he's doing. He's like, no, no, I told you. But it's to no avail, Steve. The Brontosaurus takes a healthy bite of his own turd, to God's dismay.
Ugh.
Now, real quick, before I go any further, on the Preacher panel at San Diego Comic-Con, Seth Rogen was really amazed that this scene got put in, because the dinosaur was already there, but they wanted to push to see if they could give the dinosaur a butthole. So I don't know if it was, I don't think that this whole turd eating part was even there yet, but they really wanted to give the dinosaur a butthole, and they were super surprised that AMC let them. But if you recall, AMC seems to be pro butthole. We saw the Allfathers last season.
Yes, we did. Hanging from and spitting something out.
Hanging butthole, spitting something out.
Spitting
pretty gross.
Something out. Yes.
So the Brontosaurus is chomping on his, I mean, just healthily chomping on his own turds, to God's disgust. And he burps. And when he burps, it's like a turd burp that blows wind into God's face. So now God's pissed. And he goes, you were tested and you fail. Right then and there, God destroys these dinosaurs with a meteor shower. It's pretty awesome. It was kind of a silly scene, but I think this is the kind of stuff that we like to see. This is more, it feels more comic-y to me. You know what I mean?
I mean, when we think about it, that's kind of what had to happen.
I just like that the reason for the reason for the dinosaurs' extinction is that they were eating their own turds.
I mean,
I'll buy it.
I'll buy it for, yeah. I mean,
I'll buy that for a dollar.
You can't go around eating your own turds and thinking things are just going to be hunky-dory.
Right. You're going to get sick.
You are going to get sick.
You're going to get hepatitis.
We just can't have a conversation after that. It's, things have changed now.
I was always concerned for those two girls with the one cup. Like, you know, they got really sick after that.
I don't know what you mean.
I don't believe that at all, Steve, but we'll move along. We got our title sequence with the intro that's displayed over the dinos getting destroyed. Kind of a cool shot. I liked it. Back from commercial for you cable watchers. Jesse is still riding in this truck that picked him up in the last episode, and it's hauling live chickens. Now, I didn't think anything about this the first time around, but I'll get back to that, okay? So this truck's hauling live chickens, and the woman driving is telling him about this unfortunate situation that happened where there was an electrocution that took place on a porn set that she was working on, and this caused her to leave the porn industry altogether. Jesse's kind of looking at her, because not to be mean, I wouldn't watch her porn. I'll just say that.
Wow.
So Jesse's telling her that he wants to, oh, stop it. I come real with it. Can you deal with it?
I see, dude. Wow.
You know what? There's something real quick. I'm just going to have to say the word wow can make any situation bad. You know what I mean?
That's
true. If you're in a room and someone says something off color and all it takes is someone just to go, wow. And then suddenly everyone's against them. So thanks for that, Steve. You turned the audience against me.
Also, even if it's nice, if someone's like, hey, I love your hair. And someone's like, wow. She'll be like, wait a minute. Wait a minute.
Then it becomes sarcastic.
Yeah, then it's like, wait, did I miss something? Does she not like my hair? Yeah.
So people that say wow are big jerks.
Wow.
That means you, Hudson.
I see that.
Jerk face.
So mean.
Jesse has told this driver that he wants to go to the airport. And the driver's asking him, like, where he's going. Like, why are you going to the airport? And Jesse tells her to talk to God and save the world. That's some acid taking shit right there. Like, if I pick somebody up and they said that, I'm going to be like, okay, well, this is where I'm stopping. And this is where you're getting out. Instead, the driver says, it's a bit late for that, don't you think? So she asks again, and Jesse shows her this drawing that he did from the vision that he had. I guess it's the night before, and it's kind of Richard Dreyfuss-y, kind of reminded me of Close Encounters of the Third Kind a little bit, because he has this vision of this big phallic rock. It's phallic to the point where the driver goes, you're going to a penis? And Jesse explains, no, it's not the case. It's like a mountain or a rock. So he turns to see this hallucination of Tulip now driving. In other words, the lady was there, but now Tulip's there. And she's like, you think? Seriously? You up and leave me and you don't know where you're going? Jesse kind of goes, yeah, 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 and then he snaps out of it. I really wish he would have made that sound, by the way.
Wouldn't that be cool? Yeah.
Remember that in the old days?
I remember that.
You'd get rattled. Yeah. They need to bring it back like sexy.
Oh, wow. Wow.
I'm going to go ahead and take points from myself, Steve, on that last one. I apologize to the audience.
Please do.
So as he's snapping out of this little trance that he was in, he looks out the window and he sees this little boy on the side of the road who's hunched over a dead dog. The driver says, these people will cry over anything. And Jesse asks, aren't you going to stop? She says, hell no. This kid is either a leper or a thief. And Jesse says, or a kid. And the driver keeps driving. So, of course, Jesse uses the word on her. Stop. The driver immediately stops the car.
Of course.
Now, Jesse gets out because, yeah, well, he did say stop, Steve. When Jesse gets out of the car, he closes the door. And we see now, getting back to the chickens, that this truck belongs to the Jesus de Sade House of Entertainment.
Hello.
Now we know, most of you probably don't actually, but the comic readers, you know what them chickens are for.
Hello.
And it ain't for grilling. Sex chickens is what I'm getting at. The driver tells Jesse, you go on, Father. You save the world for us. And Jesse approaches this boy who is still crying over his dead dog. The boy says, my dog, Mister, he dead. Jesse's like, what happened? Just then, this plane flies overhead, catching Jesse's attention. When he looks back to the boy, this boy's got a gun to him. He's holding a gun to him. And the boy tells him, give me your shit right now. The dog stops playing dead immediately and the truck drives off. So I'm thinking that this might have been a scam. I'm kind of wondering if the truck driver had something to do with this. Like that kid was a plant, basically.
Oh, I didn't think the truck driver had anything to do with it.
I don't know. We'll see. We will see, Steve.
That we will.
Jesse looks at this kid, this little punk, and he tells him, drop the gun. The boy drops it, and it goes off, killing his dog for real this time. Karma, bitch.
Yes.
Now the boy says it again. My dog, Mista, he dead.
Exactly the same.
Damn right, he's dead. You shot him, you little shit. Maybe that's all he knows. Like, maybe he's like just one of those. I remember on Laverne and Shirley, there was this, I'm going old school. There was guy, and all he could say was, my wife, she don't understand me.
I did not know that.
Someone out there remembers that.
Yes, I'm sure some of your classmates.
Dude, stop it. You're not that much younger than me. So I guess Jesse is now feeling bad. Even though this kid held him up, Jesse's feeling bad. So he breaks out his wallet and he gives the kid all of the cash that he has. And the boy just stares at him like, that's it? Jesse then gives him the whole wallet. Here, take the damn wallet. And the boy's still staring at him. And Jesse's like, what now? The boy looks down at his boots. And Jesse tells him, you're not getting these boots. However, the next scene we see Jesse walking down the road in the Middle East in socks. Don't do that. You're going to get bit by a scorpion.
I really don't understand why he did that.
He felt guilty, I guess. I don't know. He'll kill a bunch of people, but he felt guilty about not giving boots away. Kind of strange, so I know.
Yes. It's
super. He's got a soft spot for kids, man. Maybe that's what it is.
Ridiculous.
You know, Cassidy being able to grow back his parts was kind of ridiculous, too, wouldn't you say?
Are you feeling okay?
And another listener just unsubscribed.
Are you feeling all right?
Come back. I was just kidding. No, I'm okay. I'm feeling good. Feeling good, man. Got lots of energy.
All right.
So as Jesse's walking down the road, he looks across the highway and he sees this man riding a camel. And he kind of smiles. I guess it's like, oh, there's my ride. We cut to Hairstar, who's sitting in his chambers and he's nursing this ear hole. And Featherstone enters the room and tells him Jesse's been spotted. But she's talking to him on the wrong side. So he's like, huh? That's fucked up. So when she gets on his other side, she tells him that the vagina isn't going to carve itself. Because, you know, as we recall, that's really what Hairstar wants to do. He wants to carve a vagina into the top of his head.
Mm-hmm.
Those are hard to do. I would say that that Jesse went the easy way by just putting the slit right there. Everyone knows what that is. Now you got to get really creative. He better use like a X-Acto knife or something like that. Just putting the visual in, Steve. That's all.
Appreciate that, Dan.
Tough crowd, ladies and gentlemen. Steve Hudson, thank you very much.
I'm letting him go. I'm letting him do his thing.
But getting back to that whole vagina head, Steve, Star has something else in mind completely. And as Featherstone is plotting this death, this big grand death of Jesse, Star is like looking at his meal, which consisted, I believe it was either pasta rings or perhaps calamari. Either way.
Yes.
They are rounded. Picture like calamari, like a ring, if you will. Mm-hmm. He's just kind of tossing them to the side of his plate. And he picks up one of these little ringed food items, whatever they are. And he says, I may need some assistance. The scene strategically, Steve, cuts to Frankie, who's peeling an apple. It's just like, I love that. You know what I mean? You had talked about this on one of the Heroes of Noise episodes where it's something about the framing.
Yeah, that eye tracking. Yeah.
That was a very good example of that, by the way.
The editor did a fantastic, whoever that idea was. I don't know who came up with it, but it was very smart.
Kudos to you, sir or ma'am. So as Frankie's peeling this apple, we see that Cass is strung up yet again. And he asks Frankie if he actually came all this way just for him. And this is what he tells him.
So what, you come all the way out here just for me, did you?
Is there no local torture work going down?
Globalization. Used to be a guy who could work hard, support his family, never leave the five boroughs. Now, it ain't the same. I miss the old New York days. 70s. 80s.
Christ, I miss the really old New York days. Puking behind the back of McSorley's with Babe Ruth and Oi Madden. No.
No shit, you knew Killer Madden?
Yeah, I did, yeah. No. Do you know, I once watched him. He put a gun up a man's arse. And just blew his brains all over the ceiling, like.
Oh, man. That's classic.
Do you like that? What's funny is, that's exactly how I'm going to kill you.
They seem like they were having a touching moment.
You would think that it was touching, but no. I think Cass was playing that psychological chess with him. You know what I mean? Set him up. He's like, yeah, bitch, and that's what I'm going to do to you.
And it's interesting because it's the first time that I'm just like, okay, now I'm seeing Cass again. I wasn't seeing Cass for a while. Now I'm seeing him.
Vicious Cass.
Yes.
Frankie asks Cassidy why he didn't just leave when he had the chance. And Cassidy tells him, you know, the Irish never miss an opportunity to miss an opportunity. That's a lot of extra work.
I did not know that that was even a saying.
Irish are doing the most, Steve. It's a lot of extra work. So Frankie turns and addresses the class that's entering the room and asks them, who wants to take a crack at circumcision? So apparently some circumcisions go down, but we are left to assume that because the next scene we see is Frankie kicking Cass and he leaves him in the cell and he locks the door behind him. And from above, the archangel's like, ugh, he's a mean one.
What does he call him? Like a dog he is. I forgot what he said.
He's kind of hard to understand. I did this with no subtitles for once.
Oh, look at you.
It's a curse and a blessing. You know what I mean? I see these in advance. However, we don't get the extra stuff, but I'm not complaining. The next scene, we see this guard who's standing at the entrance of Masada, and he seems to be distracted by some kind of stain on his uniform or something like that. He's looking down. He's paying attention to that. But he looks up just in time to jump out of the way of a rocket that strikes the main entrance. From there, we see that Tulip is the one that actually fired this rocket. She looks through her binoculars to see that she didn't even dent the damn door. So that is a quality door at the gates of Masada.
That is a solid behind door.
She then gets into her car, Steve, and she drives away, just completely unaware that she's being watched by Featherstone. And we're back again in Cass's cell. He's all hunched over and probably not feeling real great. And the reason that he's not feeling real great, it's a self-induced thing because we hear these gnawing, squelching, ripping sounds. Ripped flesh is what I'm getting at, folks. And from above, the archangel's looking at him to see what he's doing. And Cass looks up at him like, grrr. And we see that he's chewing off his own leg. That's some G shit right there. That's how you get out of a situation. G.
Yes.
Well, think about it, though. I mean, he's grown back his foreskin a good 600 times already. What's a leg? Just once.
That's my thing. I just don't believe that it's... I mean, like, I'd bite off my leg if I knew that it was going to be fine. Not impressed.
When the guards finally get into Cassidy's cell, they see the severed leg, and Cass just jumps out from the dark and attacks both of them, kills them vampire style. And from above, the archangel says, oh, he's a wild one.
Because he's never seen him like this. He's never seen him, like, doing his thing. He's like, ah, look at him.
This dude's actually providing some pretty good entertainment here.
Look at him go.
Should've been friends with this guy a long time ago. So Cass does his thing and he finishes feeding on a guard and he stumbles out of the cell. He hides in a corner as Frankie and the guards are walking by and Frankie is talking on a, what do they call them now, Steve? I don't think they call them walkie-talkies anymore. What do you call those things?
I think walkie-talkies.
I thought so too, but it doesn't seem right to me. But anyway, for the purposes of this conversation, Frankie's talking on a walkie-talkie. He tells someone they better find him soon or it'll be somebody else's dick under the knife. So probably a couple minutes have passed by, and we now see Cass, who's following this Grail employee into this room. The sign outside of the door reads Urban Blight. Do you know what blight is?
No. What is blight?
Blight is a thing that spoils or damages something. So Urban Blight. We find out what that is because he walks into this room and it's full of pharmaceuticals. So, you know, it's destroying society.
Oh, interesting.
That's what I'm taking out of it. That this means they utilize the drugs to destroy society. Urban Blight. Okay. There you go. Use it. Tell five people that today. They'll be like, what the hell is Urban Blight?
Five only?
Just today. Tomorrow okay. You can do six if you want. Cool. Pace yourself. Cool. So this man is startled by Cassidy, naturally. And he asks, who are you? And Cassidy tells him, I'm the walrus. He's like, what do you want? He says, I want you. We're going to get back to Cassidy in just a second, folks. At the Holy Bar and Grail, we see that the parking lot is just full of Grail vehicles. One of the soldiers is making a toast to the fallen soldiers, including someone named Gunner, and I believe the other was named Pigeonfoot, if I'm not mistaken, from the day's battle.
Yes.
Yeah, the fallen soldiers, Pigeonfoot and Gunner from the day's battle. In the back of the room, the proprietor of the place is approached by Featherstone, who explains why she's there.
Mm-hmm. Looking for someone. Terrorist, criminal. Been checking the local establishments. You seen her?
She looks very scary, huh? But no, I would remember her.
This is exactly the sort of piss-pot shithole she's drawn to. Are you sure?
Very sure. If I see a scary mortal such as this, I will say so.
Yeah. I believe you will. Otherwise, this will happen. Put down the beer and grab some Kleenex, you babies. I want that bitch's head on a pike!
So as we just heard, to demonstrate her seriousness, how serious she is about this, Featherstone just puts a cap into this soldier. The proprietor that I was talking about, his name actually is Kamal. We talked about him last episode. And he exits the bar and walks into this garage where Tulip is working on her car. He warns Tulip that the Grail is right around and looking for her, and to which she replies, good. They talk a little bit of car talk, Steve, and her and Kamal are kind of like discussing what it's exactly going to take to soup up this car to get the job done. And he also suggests that she waits for her husband to come back before attacking Masada. So Tulip, who's under the car on one of those little slidey things, she backs out from underneath it and she tells him Jesse is not her husband and that he's not coming back. We then see Jesse, who has hitched a ride on the back of this camel that we were talking about before, and the man driving, controlling, riding the camel, steering the camel. I don't know exactly what you do when you're, what do? You ride the camel?
You ride steer the camel. I'm going to go riding.
Anyway, he sees another guy on a camel will come in their way and he exclaims, son of a bitch. The two men on camels begin to argue and Jesse's really confused and he asks what's wrong. And the man explains that the other man is a filthy Muslim. And Jesse asks, aren't you Muslim? The man says, I am Coptic. I was not familiar with Coptic until just the other day. Never heard of it. But that's me. That's me being ignorant, Steve.
I mean, hey, look, the only reason I know about that is because I listen to political talk shows.
Yeah, you're real fun at parties. Anyway, we fast forward several minutes and for no reason. I'm just playing, brother. You know I love you. Oh no. False sentiment is even worse, Steve.
Jeez Louise.
We fast forward several minutes into this, and Jesse is standing between the two of these guys as they're continuing to argue. And Jesse's getting really fed up with it, so of course he uses the word and he tells him, stop fighting. Now be friends. One of the men tries to hug the other, but is shot by that man, and he also shoots his camel as well as his own camel. The dead camel falls on the man and crushes him. He dies.
Shocking the crap out of Jesse. He's like, whoa.
What just happened? Maybe I shouldn't use the word all the time. You know, because he's using it kind of ignorantly when you think about it. He just assumes that everyone understands English because he's speaking this word of God, but not the case whatsoever.
Wrong.
And he should have considered that when, you know, headphones. He still has to work these things out.
Of course.
Jesse asked the man who's now lying down, still alive, but just barely, what exactly happened and why the word didn't work on the other guy. And the man tells him, as we just discussed, that the other guy didn't speak English. It's simple. That's Jesse, you're ignorant.
Yeah, that's fairly simple.
Jesse gets introspective real quick, and he's kind of talking to himself, and he says, if I walked out on the only good thing in my life for this bullshit, I'm going to be so. And he stops talking when he realizes that the other man died. So he's basically talking to himself. overhead an airplane flies and gets his attention really quickly. He's distracted very easily, apparently. He was just looking at a dead guy and he's like, oh, look, an airplane. You know what I'm saying?
Oh, hi, Mark.
Oh, hi, Mark. I don't know why that made me laugh so much, man, but that's the perfect thing to say. That's right, folks. We entertain each other.
That's funny.
Let's move along.
Yeah. That is so dumb. Oh, hi, Mark.
Oh, hi, Mark. The next scene has Hairstar being recognized by as the new Allfather by all of these world leaders. We have New Zealand there, Australia's there. I forget who else is there, but there's a whole bunch of world leaders there. There's all these pictures on the wall, like I said, of the Allfather's past. They are now recognizing Hairstar. They rise up, they toast him. Hairstar stands before them, all dressed in his Allfather robes, banded still over the ear. One of the world leaders asks Star if he's well, because he heard about the attack on the Citadel, and Hairstar assures him that everything's good to go. The representative from New Zealand then asks the condition of the Holy Child. From there, we get this cut to one of the Humperdoos being chased, one of the Humperdoo clones.
That was fun.
And they're being he's being chased down in the middle of the night by Grail soldiers. Once they corner him, they start to play that old soft shoe song on the speakers, and they throw him a cane, and they instruct him to dance. When the Humperdoo grabs the cane and he basically begins to dry hump this thing, they realize he's one of the clones and not the actual Humperdoo, and they execute him right on the spot. They throw him in the back of this truck filled with like a shit ton of other Humperdoo clones. Cutting back to Star, he tells him he's fit as a fiddle. What you don't know, right? The New Zealand representative asks when the Grail will present the Messiah to the world, and you can see this is annoying Hairstar, and he answers, in time. But New Zealand, not knowing what's happening, still pressing on. And he asked him, he's like, but when specifically? At that moment, Featherstone takes a cue from Star, like, oh, I know exactly what to do.
Yep.
Star gives her that look. She leaves the room. And New Zealand continues on. He's like, how can I believe in something that I can't see? Hairstar's like, with faith. Featherstone then returns, and she's got this big empty crate on wheels that she's pushing with some soldiers at her side. And she instructs New Zealand to get his ass into the box. So what do you do when they're telling you that and you're at Masada? You get into the box. He does so very reluctantly. And he gives this excuse. Like he said, I should probably say I've just had too much to drink. Featherstone hands him an unpinned grenade and Hairstar tells him to lower himself into the crate.
Jeez.
He just uses his hand. He's like, you know, making that lower sign. And the guy just lowers himself down into the crate.
Dude.
They seal this crate by nailing it shut. And from inside the crate, you hear New Zealand say, please, someone erase my search history. And boom, the grenade goes
off. Why does the grenade go off? I would have just held it for as long as I could.
Well, maybe New Zealand hasn't seen a lot of Chuck Norris action movies, and he doesn't know of this.
I mean, it's possible. I heard that Chuck Norris blows up grenades. Grenades don't blow him up.
Chuck Norris swallows grenades and shits them out as gold bars.
Oh, I didn't know that.
It's true. True story. Saw it happen once. I wouldn't recommend watching it because it's kind of gross. Lots of squelching, but that's what happens.
Wow. What's squelching again?
Picture you got like a handful of raw meat and you're kind of rubbing it together.
That's
sound.
Squelch?
Squelching. If you were to stick your hand into someone's innards and feel around in there, that sound. Squelching.
I've never heard that before.
I'm here for you, man. Again, use it 5 times this week.
Are you making this up?
Promise. You can even Google as I'm talking.
Okay, I'm not going to do that, but I believe you.
They wheel this crate out, and Hairstar's like, does anyone else have any questions?
Silence.
To which, of course, he gets like full silence, yeah. Hairstar tells him that the Holy Child will be revealed in time and just a chill, and they're all dismissed. Once they're all gone, Star kind of leans into Featherstone. He says, blame it on the Australians. It's cold-blooded, man. I like the Aussies. I wouldn't have done that myself.
That is funny.
We're with Tulip and Kamal again as they're standing right below Masada, a little bit further away, but they're checking things out. And they're mid-discussion about this plan for Tulip to make her entry in. Kamal's talking about the physics of it and, you know, expressing concern for her safety. And then we see Jesse, who's still bootless, walking through the desert in the direction of these planes that are flying overhead. Again, chop, chop with this show. That's how it is.
Of course.
We're chopping one more time, and we're going to go back to the urban blight room, you know, again, filled with pharmaceuticals, and Cassidy has tied up the pharmacist and taken his clothes and glasses.
What do you think? Do I look smart? Come here. Give me those. I'm so sorry. Mm. There's a good lad. Because these should turn me into... What am I a doctor of, anyway? Chemical pharmacology. Cool. That's drugs, right?
Yeah, it is.
Urban blight.
City wrecking, family breaking, swords, stealing drugs.
No.
Absolutely not.
No.
Give me those.
Yank.
So Cass is now in disguise. He gets on the elevator with the other Grail members. They suspect nothing. He actually gets his way to the front. And again, he's at the front. And he tells the guy, hey, I'm getting ready to leave. I got to go to a conference. The guy gets on his walkie-talkie and says, Primo, Ostium, Magnum. Doors open up. Sunlight comes through. Cassidy realizes that he is gone at the wrong time. It's daytime. He can't get out there. So he backs up. He actually tells the guy, hey, I forgot something. I'll be right back. And he takes off again. From there, the man closes the door. So they have this giant lever at the top of Masada to open the door, but it's a simple button push to close the door. That's not very effective, if you ask me.
No, and I love how it says push to close.
Right,
like,
yeah.
Obvious for the dummies. Stuff, yes.
For the dummies in the house, push to close.
Push to close.
We're back at the Holy Bar in Grail again, and Kamala's still very worried about Tulip.
I don't like this job for you, Nissa. Nissa, this is bad job.
I'm going in that door. And I'm getting gas out and this out. I don't wait and see shit for anybody.
I don't wait and see shit for anybody. That is our classic Tulip right there. But we're not going to talk about her right now, Steve, because we're back now. Cassidy comes out of this urban blight room. He went back in to get himself some provisions, if you will.
Of course.
And we noticed that there's white powder. I'm assuming it's Coke. It's just all over his face. He coughs in the elevator and Coke just flies out of his nose and makes this big old cloud. It's pretty funny. A man looks at him and Cass says, what? Well, I'm not going to blow you if that's what you're thinking. That's the first thing. That's the first thing that he thinks of. Two more men turn around and Cass is like, I'm not going to blow them either. And finally, Frankie Toscani, who I don't know how he missed him, but he turns around and looks at Cass and says, that's too bad. We trimmed our balls for nothing. I had a friend one time, Steve, he had a shirt that said, I trimmed my balls for this. It was a lot of fun hanging out with him in public. From there, a big-ass fight breaks out in the elevator, and when the doors open up, there's this big cloud of Coke just comes out, just puffs out of there, and Cass walks out. He's completely covered head to toe in Coke, all bloody, and he tells the man at the desk, I got it. He holds up the stethoscope, and he just passes out right there on the floor, and Frankie walks out of the elevator. We are now at the airport. Jesse's finally made it, and he's looking at the flight schedule. You know, the flights are and the changes, the different flights and everything. That's what he's looking at.
Okay.
He's about to light a cigarette. You wouldn't have known if I wouldn't have went.
No, I would not have. No.
Yeah, I know. That's why I did it. Jesse's about to light this cigarette, and he's approached by one of the pilots who tells him there's no smoking at the airport. And Jesse, of course, uses the word and says, there is now, which, of course, the pilot agrees that there is, in fact, smoking now. Jesse shows him his phallic drawing and asks him if he recognizes it. The pilot gives him a look, and Jesse says, it's a rock. And the pilot goes, oh, it's a rock, all right. The pilot tells Jesse it's a sacred site called the Lost Apostle and that he should get out more because apparently everyone knows this. Jesse asks where he can find this and we get an array of images telling us exactly where it is. And where is that? It's Australia. We see kangaroos and all that kind of stuff. It tells us it's Australia. We see the actual Lost Apostle on the screen and Australia flashes across the screen, preacher style, confirming that's where it is. And Jesse then makes to light a cigarette and he realizes at that time that he lost his father, Zippo. He remembers exactly where it is because when she hit the brakes, the lighter fell out on the dashboard of that Jesus Desaad House of Entertainment truck where he had hitched a ride originally. He's like, shit. We then see Kamal on the phone telling the person on the other end not to hurt her as she's a good person who lost her husband. We see who that person is immediately, and it's Featherstone who's smiling on the other end.
I love Featherstone in the first two episodes. She's so good.
Oh, dude, she's killing it. Ugh. She's killing it. From there, we see Featherstone who's dressed in this battle gear. And she pulls up to the Holy Bar and Grail, and there's three other cars that pull up. They're each driving one of their own cars. As they get ready to storm the building, she sees Tulip watching them, and she yells, go, 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 sending them all into action. Tulip escapes, though, by driving her car through the garage door, and a chase begins. And this was kind of weird. This is one of those things where I said, okay, cool. All right. This is what's happening. So the chase is going on.
Yes.
And they all manage to surround her. We see this aerial shot and they're all surrounding her in their cars, right?
Yes.
But then Tulip starts doing donuts.
Yes.
And I know what she's trying to do. She's making it too dusty for them to see, right? I'm thinking she's just going to get away.
Mm-hmm.
But you're hearing like crash, crash, crash. And you're hearing people screaming and stuff like that. And I'm trying to figure out what exactly is going on. I'm assuming that she's doing the dust thing to get them to crash their cars and off the cliff or something. I think.
I don't know what exactly they were going for here. I was like, okay, what's happening right now?
Yeah, it was kind of confusing. I didn't really get it, but I decided just to go with it. Because when the dust settles, it's just her and Featherstone's cars, and they're like head to head, right? And they're going to play chicken with each other. That's exactly what they do. Tulip takes off, Featherstone takes off, and they're playing chicken. They're going head on, and Featherstone eventually chickens out and she gets out of the way. And this gives Tulip the escape she needs, and she gets away by driving up this hill. She's got a very powerful car. She drives up this hill, and Featherstone's car can't get up there, so she starts banging on her steering wheel. She's totally pissed off because the car is just like halfway. Like, it's just this little piece of shit, little four banger, probably.
I liked her idea to make it all nice and everyone's like, you know, you can't see anything, right?
Yeah.
But
yeah.
That means she can't see anything either.
Yeah. I mean, dude, I'm going to be honest with you. This is the first scene out of the both episodes where I'm feeling like, it's just meh. It's just all right.
It's whatever. It's just showing how dope she is.
Right. But I mean, I wasn't.
You weren't impressed.
It was just eh.
That's fine.
Yeah, it was all
right. I get you.
It's fine. We're back with Cassidy again. He's now back in the advanced torture class. But this time, students are taking a crack at circumcising him. Because as we recall, Frankie got the jump on him. And Cass is like, ah, mind the tip. The student drops Cass's foreskin into this bag that Frankie's holding, and Frankie gives him encouragement by telling the class that when it comes to torture, mistakes are a part of it. He then hands this bag off to this doctor and says, who takes the foreskins away. We will be coming back to this. At one point, we're going to know what these foreskins are about. Maybe not this episode, but we will find out. Frankie steps up to Cassidy, and he lets him know he's got him all figured out.
I got him now. I worked with guys like you before. Screw-ups, meatheads. The repeat clients, guys who couldn't get out of their own way. You know, they piss and moan about being unlucky or some shit, but it ain't luck that keeps them coming back. It's guilt. They think they deserve it.
From there, he locks Cassidy back in his cell after kicking him in the face. But this is where we start to get interesting. And it's going to be a little bit of a tease, ladies and gentlemen, but if the comic readers... I'm sure this made you quite happy when you saw this and probably a little bit confused. But we are now at the DeSade House of Entertainment, and Jesse has arrived and he wants his lighter back. It's safe to be assumed that he used the word on the pilot because the pilot's the one that drove him over there. And Jesse uses it yet again and tells him, wait for me. He walks up to that truck, retrieves his lighter very easily, and then he gets back in the car and he tells him, let's go. But the pilot is fixated on something in the window. He's looking up at the DeSade House, and in the window, he points. And they both see that it's that boy from the side of the road that took Jesse's boots. But this time, he's dressed in kind of like a sailor suit or something like
that. Yeah.
And he's looking out the window, something, you know, like a little good ship lollipop kind of thing.
Yeah.
And he's crying. From behind him walks Jesus DeSade. So we've now seen Jesus DeSade in the flesh. What did you think of Jesus DeSade? I don't want to just gloss over
it. I think he looked fantastic.
I mean, he looks pretty spot on.
He looks fantastic, dude.
I got to say, I know we're going quickly, but I got to say, I can't see them doing too much with this character at the pace that they're going.
No.
And I don't know why he's in Australia now, but it's fan service.
They're
going
to do enough. I guarantee they're going to do something so off the wall that you're going to be able to you'll be like, okay, I can imagine what else he does if he's willing to do this. He's just going to do one thing crazy. Yeah. And they're like, oh, that's him. Okay.
I'll tell you this, folks, if you haven't read the comic and this character intrigues you, read it, man, because it's something else, man. Jesus DeSade's off the chain.
Oh, yes.
Back down in the car, the pilot's telling Jesse that they have to help this boy because there must be some kind of a preacher code, right? Jesse doesn't respond exactly how he wants him to. So the pilot's like, well, there sure as shit is a pilot's code, and exits the vehicle.
Nice.
And Jesse kind of rolls his eyes and reluctantly gets out and he approaches the DeSade house.
Because he's like, of course, I have to deal with this bullcrap.
Yeah, well, I mean, you know, he did give the kid his boots, so maybe he's thinking, I can get my boots back.
You know what? That might be exactly what he's thinking. I'm going with your thought.
That sounds good, right?
Yeah,
we'll see.
Skip helping the kid.
Right. But for now, we're going to go back to Hairstar, who is, this was a crazy part. I'm going to go ahead and say he's undergoing a quote-unquote semi-surgical procedure, okay? once the doctor leaves, Hare starts looking at himself in the mirror and the camera pans and we all see what those foreskins were for. A Hare Star has had the doctor fashion an extremely misshapen ear. Like it looks like, I'm going to use another pop culture reference. He had an ear like Dobby in Harry Potter. It's this misshapen ear that's made entirely of foreskins. It's fucking horrific. It's the stuff of nightmares. It looks nothing like an ear, by the way.
But he dipped. He was like, anyway, talk to you later.
Let me know if it gets infected.
Yep.
If it's discolored or painful.
Yep. Holla at your boy.
Hope the mirror doesn't work.
Yep. Peace out.
I hope that comes back like Star's just pissed off about the ear and he ends up killing this doctor. Because really, that's a pretty shitty job that he did.
I thought when he was looking at the camera that's what he was looking at. Like he was like, I'll kill him on his way out.
I hope that's what happens. I really do. Hare Star also has an iPad with him and he looks down at this iPad. Help me out here, Steve, because he's looking at the iPad that's connected to a doorbell camera, I guess you could say. But it's at the Desaad house. So he sees Jesse knocking at the door of the Desaad house.
I'd have to assume that he has eyes everywhere or Desaad is part of his groove in this story.
I'm kind of with you. Maybe Desaad has something to do with it. From there, we cut back to the side of the multi-car crash, the weird tulip spinning donuts scene. And the Grail security team is now rescuing the injured soldiers. Tulip has her disguise on now, and she's hauled off in this ambulance dressed as Marnie. We also see that her car has actually been driven by Kamal. So I'm thinking that they were both in the car and she was dressed like Marnie. I'm not entirely sure how this happened, but yeah, Kamal was definitely involved. So Tulip's disguise is so good that she actually gets into the Grail. She passes right by Featherstone on a stretcher. Kind of sloppy of Featherstone because how many women are there with blonde hair? You know what I'm saying?
Oh,
like they
yes.
just fought.
Oh, yes.
It's one of those you just have to accept it kind of things. I know I'm nitpicking. I'll move along. We then get this puzzling shot of this open door at the Desaad house and then immediately see Jesse seated on this plane. Time has obviously passed because his knuckles are bloodied and he has his boots back. Mm-hmm. So something did go down.
Yes.
And then he has another vision. I assume it's a vision. Cass appears and he's seated next to him and he's drinking these three mini bottles of vodka. And he's telling Jesse, I can't believe you. You left me, Padre. You left her too, didn't you? And Jesse snaps back to his senses and we see that he's completely alone on this airplane. So yes, he was in fact having a vision. The captain announces that the no smoking signs are now off and that he's always wanted to say that. And he's talking directly to Jesse. He tells him that they have approximately 16 hours until they get to Australia. So if Jesse needs anything, bang on the cockpit door. That's pretty good service.
Oh, yes.
Now, this is where I'm going to use yet another pop culture reference because we're pretty much coming to the end here. We see the plane and then from there we see a model of a plane. On a board, there's one of the Grail vehicles. We see Tulip's car. They're all like toys on this board. And mm-hmm. we also see models of Jesse's old church, the All Saints, and then the coffin from Angelville and a dead camel. When the camera pans back, it's revealed that we are actually in God's workshop, as they're calling it on the show. And he's been playing all this out on this board, a la Zeus. Did you ever see Clash of the Titans, the old school one?
I've never seen that, no. Oh, no, I have. I'm lying. I totally have.
Yeah, I thought you were. Everyone's seen that movie.
Yeah, the claymation one.
Yeah, exactly. And Zeus had a little model board like that. So, you know, he's playing things out. That's what it is. He's got his little Monopoly board and he's playing out how this thing's going to go down, how the apocalypse is going to happen. Okay. But we are, in fact, in God's workshop. Okay.
Okay.
God sips his coffee and he stares at the board. And behind him, you hear these weird animals that are stirring in cages. They're covered up. And I don't know what's happening. I hope I see that because I want to know what's in God's workshop, you know? But the very last thing that we see is a close-up of God's eyes. And that's it. We have made it through two episodes.
How did you like this episode?
I'll tell you, I'm going to be really honest with you. The first time I saw both of them, I watched them back to back. And like I said, the pace just felt really weird. It felt like, what's going on? I was actually confused. But when breaking the show down and kind of seeing what they were doing with it, I ended up appreciating it a lot more. And I'm kind of like fully back on board again. I'm loving Preacher, man.
I will agree with you. I think that it was a very fun film it's pretty much a movie. I did not think I was going to be in like this. I expected to come back in and be like, oh, here we go. Dude, it is fantastic. Yeah. I love these two episodes. I thought it was great. I mean, I love what's going on with Cassidy. I wanted him to get vicious, but I don't know if he's going to get vicious this season. And maybe he shouldn't. I like this arc better.
I don't know. I kind of would like to see a little bit more vamping out, but I like that there's still this animosity because that could really play into the end of the show. even though we don't really know what's happening. Yes. Like, they've shuffled the cards up so much, we're not really sure how they're going to go about it. But him having that animosity towards Jesse could make for a very interesting end of the show.
We are going to see a lot happening, I think, in the next few weeks, because they got a jam. They got a jam. They only have 8 weeks or 9 weeks to go. Yeah. So I loved it. I can't wait to the next episode. I know you got to get out of here. I love this episode.
By the way, guys, I hope you like the show. A little more expedient than normal, but next week you'll see what I'm talking about. We'll break it down a lot more. If you want to get a hold of the show, you can email us at askthewordpodcast@gmail.com. On Twitter, you can reach us @word_podcast. My name is Dan. You can reach me at Dan Q Public, Steve @SE_Hudson Music. And we have another podcast called The Heroes of Noise. So I'm about to steer you to that website, because that's where you'll find this podcast, www.heroesofnoise.com. There, folks, please feel free to leave us voicemails about the show. Do you have any predictions, theories, anything like that? What are you thinking of us? We doing a good job? I want to know. If you got friends that are interested in Preacher, do me a favor, have them subscribe. They can do that at heroesofnoise.com, or they can subscribe on iTunes, Stitcher, or wherever podcasts are basically heard. Like, we're pretty much everywhere. And please do us a favor. If you like the word, leave us a 5-star review. Let us know you like the show. There's a lot of Preacher podcasts out there, but you know what you're coming for, and it's this one. Other than that, that's it, Steve. I have nothing else to say, man. I'm looking forward to episode 3.
Thank you guys for listening. I love y'all. Peace.
Interesting way to get back into the swing of things by going 2 episodes at once like that. Really hope you guys enjoyed the show. I'm not going to keep your ear too much longer, but just know that when we return next week, things are going to slow down a little bit and we will have a little bit more fun. Like I just told you, I am looking forward to hearing from your emails and hearing your voicemails. Let's do that. Let's get you guys involved with the show. My name is Dan Ramirez. That is Steve Hudson. We have a show called The Heroes of Noise, but that's not it. This is The Word, the unofficial Preacher podcast. Folks, be good to yourselves. Be good to the people around you. And thanks for listening. To The Word.